God always punishes his people first, and then he goes to the world. When judgment is coming like that, what does God do? He separates his people. He gets his people out of that time of tribulation. He gets his people from the works of these angels and these horses, and he sets his people apart. They are marked so that they are not going to participate in that tribulation. They will be separated. They will be saved from the tribulation of that time. God, it's his nature, his character, that he saves his people and he makes sure that they do not go through the judgments and through the punishments that come upon the wicked on the face of the earth. And he said, I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. So you cannot come with a lamb or a goat and be able to make it to the presence of God. And he was telling this to the Jewish nation, not to the Gentiles, to the Jewish nation. And he told them, the only way to the Father is not through the high priest. I am the new high priest. I am the new mediator. And I'm the one that is going to bring reconciliation. Revelation 7, we have made a journey from the beginning of Revelation. And just like I asked you in the beginning, when we began in chapter 1, to first of all, set aside all the interpretations and understandings that you have had of Revelation, and let us go into the book and hear what the Word of God says, and ask the Holy Spirit to use Scripture and to interpret Scripture, to use that to help us so that we can understand what God meant and why this book is written there for us. And so I'll read Revelation 7. Last week we came all the way to Revelation 6. For some reason, we took 2 weeks on Revelation 6, and because there are issues there are critical. Last weekend we talked about the sun, the moon, and the stars and what that signifies, because we have been waiting for a cosmic event to mark the end of the time, and people are waiting for these very dramatic events. But like we saw last time, that's prophetic language. And because Revelation is a book that is written in that particular prophetic language, John the Revelator borrows from the prophets a lot, like you'll see today. And if you understand what the prophets said, then you will be able to understand the book of Revelation. When we listen to this discussion that is between God and the first audience, who are the children of Israel, we do not have the insight they have. They had, because they had learned the prophets, they understood the language of the prophets, and so when they read Revelation, it just actually interprets itself for them. They didn't need to be any deep spiritually to be able to understand this book. And so we have to go back and look at what they were looking so that we can understand. But let me just go into Revelation 7 and begin there. After these things, John is saying, after what? After Revelation 6, after these things, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth, holding the four winds of the earth, that the wind should not blow on the earth, on the sea, or on the tree. Then I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, saying, do not harm the earth, the sea, or the trees, till we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads. And I heard the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel were sealed. Let me pause there just for a second to say that this number confuses a lot of people. That smaller denominations will say, oh, this number is us. We are the chosen few. This has brought other people to say, okay, we and God know who those special people are who are already predestined for heaven. Everyone else, you are working for nothing. You are doing nothing, because we know ourselves, we are the chosen few. So some people really believe that it's only 144 people that are going to make it into heaven and have their dwelling there, because they read that here. So I want us to take time and talk about that particular place there. Who are the 144? But before we actually start interpreting it, hear what he says. Of the tribe of Judah, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Reuben, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Gad, 12,000 were sealed. The tribe of Asher, 12,000. Tribe of Naphtali, 12,000. The tribe of Manasseh, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Simeon, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Levi, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Issachar, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Zebulun, 12,000 were sealed. Note, 12,000 is the number 12 times 1,000. So, in every tribe, we are told that in every one of these tribes, there is the 12 and 1,000, times 1,000. Of the tribe of Joseph, 12,000 were sealed. Of the tribe of Benjamin, 12,000 were sealed. So that makes the 144,000. Now, if your tribe is not among those, it doesn't matter which church you go to or which denomination. If you are not one of in the tribe of Judah, Issachar, you have to understand the meaning of these words. Otherwise, your faith, if only those are going to get in, then your faith is in vain. So verse 9 says, after these things, I looked, and behold, a great multitude, which no one could number, of nations, of tribes, of peoples, of tongues, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes, with palm branches in their hands. So again, I want you to listen to this. The 12,000 from every tribe numbers the 144,000. Those who subscribe to the literal number 144,000 as those who are going to make it into heaven, they do not want to discuss verse 9. It comes immediately after verse 8. And in this verse, he sees another group. And this group is multitudes. They are not from the 12 tribes of Israel. The Bible says they are from other nations, from the nations of the world, and then from all the tribes of the world, from all the tongues of the world. So this group is more diverse. But the other thing about this group is that they cannot be numbered. They are not 144,000. They cannot be numbered. And where are they? He saw them standing in the throne, before the throne of God, before the throne and before the Lamb. They are clothed in white. If you had any doubts, they are in white. They have palm branches in their hands. So you see that those who made it are not just the 144,000. There are others that are seen here, and they are actually seen in the presence of the Lord. They are uncountable in terms of number. They are more than the 144,000. They are not from the 12 tribes. They are from all the tribes. And so you have to understand the meaning before you conclude that it's only 144,000 that are going to make it. So that's why it's very important to first of all hear what the Bible says before you try to adopt the interpretations of other people. Maybe they had a lazy afternoon and they just wanted to go and teach something. They taught something. It spread all over. And then people get that and they think that that's what the Bible says. The Bible says more than 144,000 were seen before heaven. They are uncountable in number. And that makes a lot of sense in that Jesus came to save the whole world. He did not come for 144,000. He came to save the whole world. He did not just come for the house of Israel. He came for all the nations. He wants all the nations, all the tongues to be able to stand in the presence of the Lord. And so we want to understand what that means. And verse 10 says, and they were crying out with a loud voice saying, salvation. So they are saved. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb. All the angels stood around the throne and the elders and the four living creatures and fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped, saying, amen. Blessing and glory and wisdom, thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen. Then one of the elders saying to me, who are these arrayed in white robes and where did they come from? So one of the elders has the same question that you have. And I say to him, sir, you know. And he said to me, these are the ones who come out of the great tribulation and washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will dwell among them. They shall neither hunger anymore nor thirst anymore. The sun shall not strike them nor any heat. For the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne will shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. And so let's make a few observations from that portion of scripture. But I just want to just impress this really upon you again, how important it is for you to read the scriptures and not to read into the scriptures what you have actually learned before, but always to let the Bible speak for itself, because if it speaks for itself, it brings clarity. It brings clarity to the Word of God, and then you can avoid confusion. Number one observation is that that we now can see there has been a commencement of judgment that has been pronounced with the opening of the first seal, first six seals, because we have opened up to the sixth seal. But now at this point, we have a break. We have a recess time, because this chapter 7 is not the opening of a seal, but it's something that he's observing between the opening of the sixth seal and the seventh seal, that these angels that are standing at the four corners of the world, they are actually standing, they are just about to bring judgment, but they hold the wind of judgment fast. And then he sees another angel go out to make a mark on God's people and to seal those that belong to God. And so that's what we learn here from the beginning of chapter 7. It's, I saw another angel, verse 2, and I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of the living God, and he cried with a loud voice to the four angels to whom it was granted to harm the earth and the sea, saying, verse 3, he says, do not harm the earth, the sea, or the trees till we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads. And I had the number of those who are sealed. So he's saying this, they are standing at the four corners of this land, and they are saying, they are told, hold on, this one angel comes out with a paint or whatever, and he's there going to seal. He has a seal on his hand, and he's going there to seal God's people, and he's going to seal them on their foreheads as so that they are going to be exempted from the judgment that is just about to fall. Because judgment for sure is coming to Israel, and before it actually goes and spills over to the rest of the world at that time, but this judgment is about to fall. It's very consistent, and Paul had warned about this in Romans chapter 2, verse 9. The Bible says, tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil. And he says, of the Jew first, and also of the Gentile. So God is about to come to punish those that had rejected him. He's going to punish the Romans who had put him on the cross. He's going to punish the Jews, because they are the ones who actually have the blood on their hands. Yes, Jesus died at the Roman cross, but he was put there by the Jews. They said, put him on that cross. And they said, let his blood be upon us. So when the Bible says those who pierced him, he's not talking about the Romans, he's talking about the Jews, like I'll show you in one of these places where we are going to study. So tribulation and anguish upon every soul of man that doeth evil, of the Jew first, and also of the Gentile. Judgment is coming. And 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 17, the Bible says, for it is time for judgment to begin in the household of God. And if it begins with us, what will it be the outcome of for those who do not obey the gospel of God? And so you can see the context. God always punishes his people first, and then he goes to the world. He had told these people in Deuteronomy 28, he had said, I'll bless you. I'll protect you from your enemies. No enemy will be able to stand before you. When they come against you one way, I'll send them out seven ways. He said, I'll bless you in the city and out of the city. He told them all kinds of blessing that he'll bless them with. He said, I'll be your God. You are the apple of my eye. I will protect you. I'll take care of you. I'll feed you. I'll do everything that needs to be done. And surely God did that for them. He got water for them from rocks. He gave them manna. He gave them quail. When they cried out, this is what we want, God gave it to them. No army was able to overcome the children of Israel. Even without weapons, God always fought their battles. God made sure their clothes were extending with them as they grew. And however long they wore these clothes were never torn. They were always their size. If you started with a shoe size 1, it grew with you. God made sure that they were taken care of. Their every need was taken care of. But he had given them a warning. He had said, but if you disobey me, these things are going to happen to you. And so when he comes to judge them, And we say that this is a time of divorce and God is kind of coming to punish them. He will tell them the punishment. He will tell them why. Because they have prayed harlotry against God. And so he's coming to punish them for that. He begins in the house of God. Yes, he will still go to the Romans. Yes, he will still go to other places. But he begins in the house of God. And that's why the Jewish nation was the first one to face judgment at that time. And 70 AD is when Jerusalem was breached. It's when Jerusalem was torn down, and it's when in AD 70 the temple was torn down that no stone was left on top of another. And so I want you to understand that this issue of tribulation, this issue of punishment, that issue actually was promised, and it will start with the house of Israel, like we are going to observe here very shortly. Revelation 6 ends with a warning. If you remember what we read in Revelation 6, verse 17, so we were told about the day of the Lord and how the sun, the moon will be darkened. And we talked about what that means and what a terrible day that is going to be. But he ends with this statement in Revelation 6, verse 17. Who shall be able to stand on that day? This is what it says. For the great day of his wrath is come, and who shall be able to stand? That great day of judgment, the wrath of God falling on the face of the earth, who shall be able to stand? Now, he comes to chapter 7, and he begins to answer that question. And he tells us who shall be able to stand. It is those who have received, who received the mark. Because these events are in the past. These events already happened. In the first century, before AD 70, these things happened because that's when the judgment fell, and that is when Jerusalem was breached, and that's when the temple was destroyed. And so the people who had the mark of God, the people who had been marked by this angel, that they belonged to God, they were separated from the rest, and they were saved. And these people are what the Bible refers to as the 144 that were set apart. And we are going to discuss that very shortly. So chapter 7 is answering the question of the end of chapter 6. Who shall be able to stand? And he begins by saying, I saw the four angels standing in the four corners, and they were ready now to release the judgment. But before they did, they were told, hold the winds, hold your horses for now, literally, because these are the angels that were on the horses. And then another angel appears with a marker or a seal so that he can seal God's people so they can be separated. It's a drama, but it has real events that are happening on the face of the earth. You have to understand the language of the Spirit. Sometimes the Bible, for example, the Bible will say that the angel of the Lord struck Herod. That's what they saw in the spirit. The angel of the Lord in the spirit came and struck Herod. But in the physical, the people that were there, they saw Herod being eaten by worms. He was eaten by worms. He fell and died. And he was consumed completely by the worms. So in the physical, people see a kind of condition. They see something. They see this, these worms, they started consuming the body when he was still alive. But in the spirit, had been hit. And so you have to understand that there is a war that is being waged in the spirit, because these people are not in the world, are not seeing angels. But as whatever is being waged in the spirit has a manifestation with the Roman soldiers advancing, with the Roman soldiers coming to attack, and with the Roman soldiers actually coming to pour blood. But in the spirit, what you see is an angel with a pale horse, is an angel with a different kind of horse. That's what you see in the spirit. An angel with a dark horse, that's what you see in the spirit. In the physical, you see hunger, you see famine, you see, because he has a scale, that means he's coming to weigh something, that means hunger and famine has come on the land, and you know how those events actually unfolded. So let me make another observation here. With the four angels on the four corners of the earth, they start that stands for a period where judgment is imminent. Judgment is imminent, it's coming upon the land. But you note something that is significant in that when judgment is coming like that, what does God do? He separates his people. He gets his people out of that time of tribulation. He gets his people from the works of these angels and these horses, and he sets his people apart. They are marked so that they are not going to participate in that tribulation. They will be separated. They will be saved from the tribulation of that time. So I want you to understand that God, in his nature, It is him, his character, that he saves his people and he makes sure that they do not go through the judgments and through the punishments that come upon the wicked on the face of the earth. If he, God, allows you that you go through persecution, is so that you can qualify for a great crown that he keeps for those who go through those special. And even some of, because Peter understood that, he counted it as an honor that he died the manner of death that he died. He was persecuted, he was actually martyred, and when he died as a martyr, he knew that the crown of glory was waiting for him for actually going through that level of, punishment and that level of judgment. But God, in his nature, always holds the winds of judgment until he gets his people out of the way so that he can come and reign and bombard the nations with the judgment. And this is typical of nations. Whenever you go back in the day, Desert Storm, back in the day, you remember when America was just about to hit Kuwait. Back in the day, I think it was Kuwait, and it was Iraq that had gone actually into another country. And so when they were ready to actually start bombing and hitting them in their strongholds, in the places where they were, if you remember back in the day, they called all the Americans. They said, Americans, come back, because they could not start storming and bombing the place until they had their own people safe back home so that they can start raining havoc. And sometimes when they are just about to attack a nation, you know how they will say everybody, when they know their people are back home, that is when judgment comes. And that is typical of powerful nations. They will always secure their people first, and then they will bring judgment. And that's what heaven does. It will bring judgment. But the people of God have to be set apart. And I know how many people that, if you have been watching some of these movies of people that have been left behind, I hope you're not one of them. But if you have been actually a fan of those movies and a fan of those things, you know how confused they confuse the character of God. It's not consistent with what God has said and what God does. God is not careless with his people. If you serve God, the Bible says the servants are going to be marked. They are going to be separated. And the same thing that he did among the children of Israel, he told them overnight, mark your doors. If you want to be saved, just put a mark on your door. And once you put that mark, I will see it and I'll come and rain judgment. The heathen are not going to see it. Everybody is not going to see it, but the angel of death will be out attacking. And when he sees that mark, he is going to pass over your house. And the same thing. And so when the children of Israel, or when this letter is written to the church in the first century, and they read about the angel marking God's people so that they are going to be exempted from judgment, they understood it from what they know from Exodus 12. They understood it exactly, that this is the same mark that allowed us to be able to be passed over by the angel of death on the night of the Passover. And so that is, so the, also the winds, that the four winds are symbolic of destruction. They are symbolic of the destruction that was coming. So an angel appears. Another observation is that with a seal, and he hears, John hears a loud voice, and I'll read it. This is verse 3. The voice is saying, do not harm the earth, the sea, or the trees till we have sealed the servants of our God on their foreheads. And I had the number of those who were sealed, 144,000 of all the tribes of the children of Israel were sealed. So one of the things I want you to know is that the seal is not a literal mark. It's not a mark, a literal mark that someone came and wrote upon them. It's done by an angel. It's not done by a human. So they are not putting a physical mark on somebody's face. But they understood the context of that to be the same kind of mark that was there. Although the mark in Egypt was a literal mark, and they are the ones who put it, this one is being put by the angel. God is just saying, it's dramatic so John can understand, but what God is saying is the angel that will come to secure God's people and take them out of the way before judgment falls, that angel is the one that is coming out of the east and coming so that he can protect and remove God's people. That's what we are seeing here as a mark. So the number of those sealed is 144,000. So when they hear that, how do the children of Israel understand? We are the only people that would take this literally. The children of Israel know this in a different way. It's prophetic language. 12,000 out of the one tribe, 12,000 and out of 12,000 out of each of the 12 tribes, and that makes 144. So you have to understand what the number 12 stands for. The number 12, God uses that number many, many times, talks about perfection, and also talks about authority. There are 12 tribes in Israel. Jacob had 12 sons. You know how Jesus came and chose 12 apostles. These are the 12 disciples of Christ. That number is significant, and Christ comes and actually puts a seal on that. 12 is used so many times in the Bible. It's used actually 187 times in the Bible, and it's used so many times with a lot of significance, and it plays a significant role in Revelation, the book of Revelation. And so you want to understand, it's not literally that these are the 12,000. What he's saying is that we have a perfect number, but also the 1,000 is not a literal 1,000. If you want to interpret some of these verses literally and get the meanings of them literally, what will happen is that you're going to get some absurdities in the process of that. Because if the Bible says that God owns cattle on 1,000 hills, what happens? Whose are the cattle or the animals that are on hill 1,025? Because there are so many hills on the face of the earth. So when he says God owns cattle on 1,000 hills, the previous verse before that, that's a word in Psalms, and I'll show you that in Psalms. I think it's in Psalms 50. What happens is that the previous verse talks about that God owns the whole world. God owns animals in all the hills of the world. That's why he says he owns cattle in 1,000 hills. That is prophetic language to say that in all. So in the 12,000 is the perfect and the fullness of it. So when he goes to one tribe, like the tribe of Judah, and we hear 12,000, what he's saying, he takes a full number. He takes a full number of the people of Judah that are the servants of God, that are the righteous, that actually are born again, the Christians, the Jewish Christians that are in Judah. He takes the whole perfect number of them. And they are not just a few that have gotten saved. He has a full number that is able to propagate and take the gospel to the rest of the world. And he saves that seed so that that seed of Judah will remain. It's not a small number. It's a perfect number. It's also a perfection of leadership. It's also a complete number. It's not of weaklings. It's people that are strong, that are washed in the blood of the Lamb. And so he takes from every tribe. You see, all tribes are favored equally. There's an equal number. There's an equal number or an equal or a proportional number, because they are all taken in their strength, in 1,000, 12 in 1,000. So when you read the number 144,000, it can be 144, if that is the perfect number, it can be that. But I want you to know it's not literally 144,000. It may be more or less, but what this number actually signifies is that that number in Judah is enough. And those nations were not very big nations. Even today, you know, the children of Israel, are not too many. These were not very big nations. And so they did not have a lot of people. So if you heard that he only selected like 5,000 from the tribe of Judah to escape, you may think that these are very few people, so that the context, and maybe 100 years from now, this world will be so full that even 5,000 will seem very insignificant. But if they read the number 12 times 1,000, they know that that number was a complete number for the number they were in that time. Proportionately, that number was a complete number. And so that is the understanding that you get from there, that these numbers are not literal, they are symbolic. And if Psalms 50 verse 10, I see you already saw that. And of course, there are more than 1,000 hills. And we know that these are the people that were marked. 12 times 1,000 are the people that were marked by God. And these are the people that received that mark and that seal. and on their foreheads. And so it's not a literal seal, like many people are waiting, and that's why some people are not even, considering the vaccine, because they think the vaccine, I don't know whether they're expecting it to go on the forehead and on the heart. You remember all that stuff that was going on, especially among Christians, that the vaccine is a chip. And now some of you are quite learned, and so you know that, on those tubes, they are not injecting chips inside of people. So you can see what actually how people misinterpret some of these things. So what do these images actually stand for? Let me read for you in Ezekiel chapter 9, verse 3. Actually, let me tell you something that you may not know. John borrows a lot. Most of the imagery that you find in John, actually he borrows it from the book of Ezekiel. The language of expressing himself, he borrows it from there. The descriptions around the throne, actually, you find them very similar to the book of Ezekiel. And so that is something that you note here. But Ezekiel 9, verse 3, he says, "Now the glory of God, of the God of Israel, had gone up from the cherub where it had been to the threshold of the temple. And he called to the man clothed with linen who had the writer's inkhorn at his side. And the Lord said to him, 'Go through the midst of the city, through the midst of Jerusalem, and put a mark on the foreheads of the men who sigh and cry over all the abominations that are done within it.' To the others, he said in my hearing, 'Go after him through the city and kill. Do not let your eyes spare, nor have any pity. Utterly slay old and young men, maidens, and the little children and women, and do not come near anyone on whom is the mark, and begin at the sanctuary.'" So you see, here the same idea. There's a man here clothed with linen. He has a writer's inkhorn at his side. And the Lord said, "Go through the midst of the city and put a mark on the foreheads of the men who sigh and cry for Israel." And so you see that this is not a completely new idea in the book of Revelation. And so don't get all scared when you read Revelation like something new is going to fall on the face of the earth. The first century Christians knew that what they had been told was coming in the near future actually had been talked about before that. So let's make other observations from this narrative here. You find the events that are described here in the book of Revelation, all the events you read about and what we were reading last week from Revelation 6, these things were to happen very shortly after the vision of John. They were not going to come many years later. Like you read in Revelation 1:1 and 1:3, this, "Let me show you, come, I'll show you things that must come, happen soon." And then Revelation 3 says they have to take, because the time is at hand. And he repeats it several times in the first and the second chapters that these things are not for another generation. And you read in Matthew 24, Jesus said, "This generation is not going to pass until all these things happen." And we said the last time that a generation is 40 years. When Jesus is saying these things, it's around AD 30. And when he talks about a generation is 40 years, this is AD 70. And we know from history that the temple was destroyed in AD 70, and that temple has never been rebuilt again. That was a final judgment that was given to the temple, and God is never going to come back in a temple. Jesus died once and for all. And he said, "I'll rebuild my house." And now the temple of the living God is no longer in a place called Israel. Neither are we going to see sacrifices again happening in the land of Israel, because Jesus gave the one sacrifice that was enough. And he said, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So you cannot come with a lamb or a goat and be able to make it to the presence of God. And he was telling this to the Jewish nation, not to the Gentiles, to the Jewish nation. And he told them, the only way to the Father is not through the high priest. I am the new high priest. I am the new mediator. And I'm the one that is going to bring reconciliation. And so that temple was going to be destroyed. And what I'm saying with this is that these things were to happen in the first century generation, as Jesus had said, and he said, you will see these things with your very eyes. On the cross, as Jesus was crying out, he told the women that were there crying for him, he said, women of Jerusalem, do not cry for me. Cry for yourselves and your sons. Because he knew what was just about to fall on the land. He knew judgment was coming, and he knew that it was going to be tough for them, and he had described it for them actually in the Olivet Discourse, when actually you read from Matthew 22 all the way to around 25, towards the end of 25, he discusses the punishment, and then he transitions to talk about the second coming of Christ that we are still waiting for. We are still waiting for the coming or second coming of the Messiah, but about the end of the age that was the age of the of Judaism and of the law and of the rule and authority that was there in the temple, that age actually came to an end, and 70 AD was the final stroke when the temple was destroyed, and everybody knew that that age actually is done. So the people are marked and are called servants of God, and Jesus had spoken about that. And what the other thing I want you to also note is that in this time, the marking of God's people so that they can be saved is associated with a particular historical event. And I'll go back, because I talked about this when I did the series on the end times prophecy. I'm going to go back into some of those as we come to chapter 13. But when we were doing that series, I told you about the kings and the generals that were fighting. The general that is coming now to destroy Jerusalem, he has come with a battalion from Rome. His name is Vespasian. And Vespasian, so the angels that you are seeing, there's something that is happening on the face of the earth. There's something is transpiring among the Jewish people that they are hearing rumors of wars. They hear the Romans are marching against the cities, and then they see war. Because war comes to Galilee, the small towns. But Vespasian was a very skilled general, because when he came, he did not come straight to Jerusalem. He started attacking the Jews from all the surrounding cities and killing those that were resistant, but forcing them and pushing them. And as they were running away and fleeing, they ran away towards Jerusalem. They were going there, and because Jerusalem was their strong city and it was very well walled. So he pushed them and he fought with them. And when they came around Jerusalem, what he did is he started, they had come with their building material. They used to come huge armies, and they would come with their own brick and mortar, and they started building around the city, and they built around the city of Jerusalem and around the Jews that were in it. Instead of fighting with them when they are strong, they just built a wall, a big wall, and that in that way they were able to enclose them so that they would be able to wait them out until they finished their resources of water and food, and then they'll attack a weak nation of Israel. And that is what Vespasian did. And so he pushes them and he fights with them and he pushes them towards Jerusalem. And this is around AD 68. He had been commissioned to do that by an emperor called Nero, one of the worst emperors. And you remember we said that this is a guy whose name corresponds with 666. Or 666, we said, though people will say 666, it's 666. And so the Vespasian comes at the command and commission of Nero, and he comes and pushes, and he wants now to just wait out and then destroy Jerusalem, and he's ready and he's equipped for that. He was a very good general. But something happened in AD 68. Nero committed suicide. Nero committed suicide. And because Nero did, Vespasian no longer has a commission. He has to wait for the new emperor. And the new emperor that is going to come to power is going to say whether the war is going to continue or not. Because Vespasian has no particular command, he needs to leave his post. He needs to go and pledge his loyalty to the emperor that is there and then come with a new command. But he leaves the soldiers and he leaves some of the people there. And so, but they cannot wage war against Israel, although Israel do not have this kind of news. Vespasian goes back actually to Rome. And when he goes back, instead of getting a new commission, Vespasian becomes the emperor. He becomes the new emperor of the Roman Empire. He remembers this Jewish nation and a war that he had started, and he takes his son, Titus, and he takes him and he says, he was a very good general, and he tells him, go and finish what I started. So a general, Titus, who was the son of Vespasian, comes back to Jerusalem, and he is the person who gave the final destruction, the final stroke that completely destroyed the children of Israel. And we described that some time back, but I want you to know that whatever happened among these children is really a very difficult thing. In the time Vespasian left and the time Titus came, it was a very short period, but within that time, because of the prophetic word that God had given to the children, to the church and to Christians, and because of how much they trusted in his word, these Christians knew that what Jesus had said is, when you see that and you see that opportunity happen, if you're on the rooftop, do not go back in the house. When that door opens, you go out and flee to the mountains. That's what he told them. If you're out in the farm, don't go back home. When you see that door open, you go out and you run and flee to the mountains. And the Bible says, in a miraculous way, Christians, because of being forewarned, and these are secular historians who write that because of being forewarned by a prophetic word, they fled and left the city, and everyone was left inside the city. The Christians were able to escape, and they ran and went to a small town, not too far, but they went towards the mountains, and then the guard came back, and Titus came back, and the door was shut. The window that actually they escaped was a very short time, and they only escaped because they remembered the word of the Lord. And actually what they said is, you know what is happening? These guys look like they are a little confused. Let's leave. And they left, and Christians were able to escape. And that is what actually we were reading, that they were marked by the angel. That's what we see in the spirit, but in the physical, the Christians were able to escape from all the tribes, and these are Jewish Christians. They were able to escape out. And actually, what we see in verse 9 of Revelation 7, where we see now a multitude, because of them, they became a seed that went to all the nations of the world. And then we had believers who are coming out of that seed, and actually a resurgence of the power of Christianity. And those who had been lukewarm and those who had actually started falling away, there was a resurgence of Christianity, and that is a multitude that he sees standing before the throne of God and before him. This is another multitude, that is verse 9. And these things I looked, and behold, a great multitude after these things. After these things is the key word there, is after they had escaped. After all these things, then he saw that. It's after the marking of the perfect number, is after they had escaped, then he sees that different number. They are not just the 12 tribes. They are not just the nation, the nation of Israel. They are not just the people of God that were in Israel. These are the people that are wearing white, signifying that these people have been saved and they have made it out of the tribulation. So the tribulation, we know it's not an event that is coming in the future. These events that we are reading about happened in the first century, and that is what the Bible teaches. Everyone else that is coming with very dramatic explanations of things that are coming in the future, and I will tell you this, because I stand in the authority of God's word, whatever they tell you, it may be good, their followers may swallow them, may swallow those words that they are telling them. They can tell them and believe it. They can write books. They can sing songs about that. But what the Bible says will stand true. These events, Jesus said, they are coming shortly. He said it in Matthew. A few years later, he told that to John in heaven, when he was already on the throne with authority, and he shows John this in a dramatic form, and he tells him these things are happening shortly, and that when he's telling him that is before AD 70, and then the destruction comes. And he had said it, that I'll destroy your house. He had said it in a parable before. He said it in Matthew 20:23. He had told them that a man had gone out. He was going on a journey. He had left his farm with some people to take care of it and tend it. And then he sent his servants to come and check. He sent people to come and check. And every time he sent people to come and check on his vineyard, the people that were supposed to take care of it actually killed those he sent. So finally he says, I'll send my own son. And when these people saw the son, they said, leader, this son is the heir of this kingdom. Let's take him and kill him. And so he asked the Pharisees and the Sadducees who were there, he said, then what do you think the master will do when he comes to these people who have killed his son and all the servants? What will he do? And he said, then they answered, they said, he will kill them and he will destroy their city. And that's what Jesus said. And he said, this is you. This is you. And he said, this is what you have done. And their destruction is coming. And God is going to come and destroy, and the temple will also be destroyed. And so that Jesus prophesied, and we know it happened in AD 70, and we know that that was the final stroke that ushered in the time of the Gentiles and ushered in this time that we actually are in when the gospel is reaching the rest of the world. It's not a tribulation that is coming years to come. It's not something that we are waiting for a mark of 666 or something like that. If you are part of our church here, and you actually start getting scared from these prophets that are all over the world saying those things. And I want to just tell you this. There is dignity in acknowledging when you have believed something wrong. There's dignity in that and saying, I was deceived there, or I never checked this out. I trusted those who taught me. And there's dignity in saying that and then adopting the truth. It's easier to adopt the truth because this word here is sweet. Revelation is not a book to be feared. It's a book to be read like any other book in the Bible. And because of the ignorance of the people, you know how this book in 2020 has almost destroyed the lives of so many people because of some of the misunderstandings of the prophecies of this book and actually taking them out of context to put them in an era or a time that they never belonged. I want you to understand that judgment came, and that judgment came on the house of Israel, and the temple was destroyed and the city was burnt up, and that time was actually the final time for the temple. And then we came to the new season, we came to the new time, and Revelation is just about that. So the events that you see playing out as the seals are being opened are between three people. It's no longer now just about the one who sits on the throne, but it's about the Lamb, it's about the harlot, and the bride of Christ. The harlot is Israel, and who is being divorced and thrown out, and now the bride of Christ, the church, is coming in. And actually, I also want you to understand that Israel being the harlot is the covenant they were in, the old covenant. But under the new covenant, as part of the church, the Jewish Christians are welcome as much as the Gentile Christians. And out of the two that had a wall of separation, God has created a new man who is neither Jew nor Gentile, but one whole new man in Christ. And so there's neither Jew or Gentile. There's neither one that is favored or not favored. Because if we were in a fellowship here and someone said, oh, this one is a Jew, this one is a Kikuyu Kalenjin or whatever, who is going to give us the word? Many people will say, no, let a Jew give us the word, because they think that they are more favored by God. The Bible says Jesus came to usher in a new era. The Jews and the Gentiles are the same. And Jesus said, there's no other way. There's no other way. Judaism is not the way. The other covenants are not the way. The way is Christ. He is the way. He is the truth and he is the life. No one comes to the Father by any other way except through Christ. And every Jew gets saved the same way as every Gentile. And they were not few. Back in the day, people like Paul, Peter, all these books of the Bible are written for us by Jews. They are written for us by Jewish Christians, and who believed in the Messiah. And still, we still have many Jewish Christians, but many of us have taken that out of context. May God bless you. May God help us so that we'll be able to go into the next chapter. When we come to chapter 8, we are going to open the seventh seal. When the seventh seal opens, then it opens another series of events that we are going to discuss so that you can understand them. But the events we have discussed so far, you know how it is playing out between the Romans and the as who are being used by God as the hand of God to punish an adulterous wife who is just about to be divorced. And we say that the document that had seven seals, the scroll that had these seven seals, that is the divorce decree that was given to the children of Israel. And I hope that brings you to a certain level of understanding. So whenever you hear people say it's only 144 that are getting in, it's good to let them know that 144 were the Jews that were escaping that tribulation of that time. So those are the Jews that escaped there. And so it's okay to believe the 144, but also to know that it's not a literal number. You have to understand the symbolism of that so that you can actually be able to appreciate everything that God says there. So may God bless you. I hope this was edifying. I hope it was helpful. And I hope it answers a lot of the questions that are there in your mind. May God bless you. And let's pray together. Father, thank you for speaking to us. Thank you for your ministry to our hearts. And King of Glory, I pray that you are going to continue to open up these words so that, Father, they are going to have meaning. There are people that are listening, while listening to these words. Father, they are eager to know more. They are eager to have a deeper understanding. And Father, in the coming days, I pray that you're going to continue to open these words again to their hearts. Let these words be written inside of our lives, that this book is never going to be a mystery to any of us ever again. That we will never live our lives in fear, all uncertainty. We'll never question your anger or character and whether you love us or you are angry about us. Father, there will be no confusion about what a loving God does with his people. A mighty God, you are going to help us to live our lives directed by you, not by the deception of our day. Help the spread of this word, that others may know it, they may run with it. Others that are going to be faithful to share it with other people. And Father, I ask that in Jesus' name, that that will be our portion. Deliver us from deception. Father, deliver some of the people that are listening to me that were deceived, completely deceived. Change their theology, change their understanding. And Father, pull out any deception that was there in their lives so that they can be able to walk and live in the truth. We give you praise. I bless your people tonight. And wherever they are, Father, may your hand be upon them. This is our season of harvest. This is our season of supernatural increase. And Father, I pray that in Jesus' name, the abundant harvest that, Father, you have promised us, and we have started seeing among us, that it will continue in the lives of your people. Supply to their needs. I pray that, mighty God, none among us tonight is struggling or going through a difficult issue, feeling like they have no help or hope. King of Glory, stretch your hand. And Father, stand with them and help them. Stand with them and help them and encourage them. And mighty God, give them the strength to be able to continue and continue in life. We give you praise and we thank you. In Jesus' name we pray, believing and trusting. Amen.